seems to have a lot of kinks to work out, both in here and campus-wide. So, but thanks for being here. What we want to do is have kind of an official Aver Chapel every 2 weeks, but actually we're in here every week, every Thursday morning. So please join me for a prayer, and then we'll sing a couple songs. Loving Father, you are very good to us, and we thank you for the opportunity to be here at Aver University. We thank you for the opportunity to worship you and your son, Jesus Christ. And we just pray that you will use this time to encourage us and inspire us to be better, and to be better for you. We pray these things in Christ's name. Amen.
Thank you. Forgiveness was brought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. He altered the Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was brought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ.
Okay, you guys can have a seat. Okay, so again, welcome to Chapel, guys. And like I said, we're still working out a lot of kinks in here, out there, all over the place. So, just let me go actually do the announcements that I was supposed to do earlier. Just a couple things. Remember that on Tuesday nights we have CSF Focus at 8:30 p.m. right here. And that's a little bit, kind of longer and more fun. We don't have more fun. That's a good time that we have. I want to let y'all know that this fall break we're going to do a mission trip. I'm going to lead it. We're going to go down to Durham, North Carolina. We're going to help serve alongside some missionaries who serve there. And they actually work with refugees who are settling here from Burma or Africa or all kinds of places, typically like war zones. And these are people who maybe they don't even speak English. They're in a very difficult space. And so these missionaries serve them. They kind of integrate them into their community. And so we're going to spend time kind of serving them, helping them, maybe setting up an apartment, helping with like world relief kind of agencies. We're going to spend some time worshiping with refugees. And then we'll spend a lot of time doing like faith integration. So that's going to be like on fall break, like Wednesday to Sunday. So please, if you're interested, talk to me. That'll be cool. So our next Aver Chapel in 2 weeks is actually going to be sponsored by, in 2 weeks is Gary, and then in a month is the Black Student Union. Is that right, Isaiah?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so actually one of these chapels is going to be totally sponsored by Black Student Union. So, all right, let me read to you some scripture. This comes from the book of 1 Peter, which I don't find myself like speaking from very often for some reason. But 1 Peter chapter 4, and I guess I should get my Bible, huh? No, I didn't put that scripture up there. So this is what Peter says. The end of all things is at hand. Amen. All right, let's go. Let's go home. He says, the end of all things is at hand. Therefore, be serious and watchful in your prayers. And above all things, have fervent love each other deeply. For love will cover a multitude of sins. Love each other deeply, for love will cover a multitude of sins. Be hospitable to one another without grumbling. As each one has received a gift, minister to one another as good stewards of the manifold grace of God. If anyone speaks, let him speak as the oracles of God. If anyone ministers, let him do it as with the ability which God supplies, that in all things God may be glorified through Jesus Christ, to whom belong the glory and dominion forever and ever. Amen. Okay, good word, Peter. So the end is near. Every time a president is elected, half the country is certain that it is true. Okay, the end is near. Every time I tell my 3-year-old daughter that she can't have a piece of candy, she puts her face in her little hands, and she falls to the floor, and she is certain that the whole thing is coming to an end today. Our spouse walks in and tells us he wants a divorce. A parent calls and tells us a family member has suddenly died. An injury ends a season. The doctors find a malignant tumor in your body. The company lays us off. We can't pay the bills. We can't keep up with the work. We can't manage the stress. We don't know what to do with the pain that someone we love has caused us. The end is near, right? Every time I scroll through Facebook, someone is convinced that some cultural political phenomenon is igniting the end of the world. I'm a youth pastor, so sometimes I sit patiently with these like 7th grade girls who are certain that, their 7th grade math teacher holds the fate of their life in his hand, or some like cute boy or something. The end is near. That's why I love Peter here so much, because he just says it, okay? The end of all things is near. He's like, let's just put this on the table, okay? It's actually an obvious truth. At some point, you are actually going to die, or at some point in time, the world will actually end. The end actually is near, in that sense. What are you going to do about it? What are we going to do about that kind of lurking fear in our hearts, or what are we going to do about the time when things go crazy? What are you going to do when you fail a class in college? What are you going to do when the bottom completely falls out of your finances? Your entire family is in disarray. What are you going to do when you don't get the job you want? What do you do when your daddy won't give you a cookie? What are you going to do when you feel like the world is going crazy, when you feel like the world is going to hell in a handbasket? What are you going to do when there are literally Nazis on TV just up the road, and they have tiki torches that they bought from Home Depot because apparently white supremacists cannot tolerate mosquitoes?
That was good. I haven't heard that one.
Racists are really weird. So what do you do when you feel like everything is spinning out of control? One thing you could do is you could like rant or complain on social media. What you could do is you could go home, pour yourself a nice stiff drink, or you could go out for some like super crazy party, and you can just kind of like go out into oblivion, right? Maybe you could just stuff all that stuff down inside you, you know, and just hope that somehow it doesn't like blow off on someone you love, and you don't hurt someone you love or hurt yourself down the road. There's all kinds of ways that our world is trying to compensate. And they're trying to deal with the craziness that's going on around them and within them. Our world is incredibly anxious and afraid and looking for meaning. Our soul senses on a deep level that the end of all things might be near. We know our lives are short. We seek purpose and meaning. Our world finds all kinds of incredibly destructive, painful, hurtful ways, shallow ways of dealing with that. But Peter offers us alternative wisdom to the question of how we respond when we feel like things are difficult and crazy and chaotic, and we just don't know what is going to happen to us. He tells us to spend time in prayer. Show hospitality to people. Serve one another with the gifts you've been given. When you speak, speak as if God is speaking through you. Serve others with the strength of God. This is like his practical advice. But above all those things, even greater than all those things, more important than those things, above all these things, love each other deeply. Because love covers a multitude of sins. Love each other deeply. Because love covers a multitude of sins. Peter is not naive. He knows that love is not easy. He's not calling us to love sinless or perfect people. He recognizes that our call to love is for people who say stupid things and hurtful things and do destructive things. Peter recognizes that our call to love deeply is for the people who have betrayed us and let us down and neglected us. This is what our world really needs when things are bad, he says. Love covers a multitude of sins. Whatever you're going through, the deep love of Christian community will cover it. The deep love of Christian community has got your back, and you're going to be okay. I'm not talking about gushy sentimentalism. I'm talking about the kind of love that is a verb. To love someone deeply is to love with action, to make actual sacrifices to make sure they're going to be okay. To love someone deeply is to be present in people's suffering. To love someone deeply is to do what you can to help them in a time of need, even if it calls you to sacrifice your own resources of time or energy or money. To love someone deeply is to be willing to take a risk on someone. So whatever happens, whether it's a hurricane in Texas or the KKK up the street or the death of someone you love or a bad report from the doctor or the stress of the semester, that deep love of those who follow Jesus will cover it. It will cover a whole multitude of sins and disasters. This semester, how are you going to respond to the chaos and confusion of your life? of your friends' lives, of the people in our world, of what's going on in our own community, when it seems like the end of all things is near. It starts right here in this place, like with these people. We have to love each other deeply as Christ has shown us. We have to commit to supporting one another this school year, strengthening one another, encouraging one another, sacrificing for one another, taking risks for one another, to be present for one another during our times of anxiety and pain. That's what we have to do. And we can pray, we can show hospitality, we can serve one another with the gifts we've been given, we can choose our words as if God is speaking through us, we can serve others with the strength of God, but above all, we have to love each other deeply. Because even if the end is near, love is going to cover a whole multitude of sins, and it's going to be okay. Please pray for me. Lord God, I pray that you help us to love one another deeply. This is the call. This is how we respond. This is what we do with the anxiety within us. We channel it into love, and we channel it into receiving love from one another. God bless us this semester, and make us more into the image of your Son, Jesus Christ, every day. Amen. Okay, so our band is going to come back up. We're going to sing one last hymn together. And I'm actually going to pass this around. This is like our collection offering. So if you happen to have any cash on you, or even if you want to write a check for God's Pit Crew for Hurricane Harvey relief, we wanted to go ahead and take a stab at that. If you don't have anything, that's perfectly, perfectly fine. There's also a collection bucket at the door if you have a water bottle in your pocket. So actually, it's more of just a symbol. I want you guys to know that we are doing this. We are reaching out, and we are loving people have lost absolutely everything, so including their lives. So we need to step up and do our part. So I'm going to pass this around. Feel free to chuck something in there or not. It's totally fine. But as we do that, please stand and sing Joyful Glory with us.